Go tell that long-tongued liar. Go and tell that midnight rider. Tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter. Tell him that God's gone. Tell him now. Tell him that God's gone.
Welcome back to another edition of the Prepper Recon Podcast. Our mission is to bring you great interviews with preppers from around the world so you can be better informed and better prepared for everything from a hurricane to the end of the world as we know it. This episode is brought to you by CampingSurvival.com. Whether your plan is to bug out or bug in, CampingSurvival.com has all of your preparedness needs, including bug-out bags, long-term storage food, water filters, gas mask, and first aid kits. Check them out online today at CampingSurvival.com. Be sure to enter coupon code PREPPERRECON for a 5% discount on your entire order. Today's guest is Todd Sepulveda, author and creator of Prepper Website. Todd, thanks for coming on the show today.
Hey, thanks for having me, Mark.
Absolutely. It's our pleasure. What initially woke you up to the need to prepare?
Well, I've talked about this several different occasions. I guess for me, I consider my journey into preparedness starting in a spiritual way. I'm an administrator in the public school system. So during our Christmas break, I have a little bit of time just to kind of stop and reflect. And I'm also a minister. So I use that time to kind of, get ready for the next year, as in thinking about, you know, praying about where we're headed. And in one of those times for me, I just really felt, you know, at the end of the year and you're looking towards the new year, a lot of times people, or at least, you know, they start thinking about a fresh new start. You start, you know, if you're going to church and you hear sermons, they start, you know, start pointing you that way to, you know, a fresh start. And or even, I've had this happen before, just using the year, like 2010, 10 scriptures to, you know, to keep you motivated, you know, in your relationship with God or whatever, you know, something like that. And I just wasn't feeling it then. And it just was really, really bothering me. And, there were some things really bothering me. You know, one of the scriptures that came to mind, I feel like, you know, I needed to go read it again, was Amos 3:7. Which says God doesn't do anything without revealing His will to His servants, the prophets. And as a Christian, as a believer, as a minister, you know, reading the Bible, you kind of start seeing that God always let His people know what was about to happen or what was going to happen. He always gave them warning. They just never listened. And for me at that time, that's what it kind of felt like. It felt like a warning that, you know, you have to get ready because there's some things just that aren't right. And that's kind of where I started my journey into preparedness. One of the things that I do as an educator is I train, you know, teachers how to use stuff like Twitter and blog posts or RSS readers. And podcasts and stuff like that on how to use that to build themselves up professionally. And when I started, you know, getting into preparedness and stuff like that, I applied those same things to preparedness. So I'd hit a website that I thought was interesting, and I'd put that into my reader. And then, you know, hitting one website leads you to another one. By the time you know it, you know, I had all these different websites, you know, together. And I just come home and when I had some time in the evening time, when things kind of settled down, I'd start reading and researching and those kinds of things. And, you know, one thing kind of led to another. And, that's kind of where I got my start.
And then I guess that's, also what led to you putting together a Prepper website, because you were going to all these different sites and you wanted to find a way to bring them together. Is that right?
Exactly. I kind of imagine people, and you know, when I look at the demographics of Prepper website, I mean, the biggest demographics, I have the demographics, you know, the people are coming from everywhere in all walks of life. They're a little bit older with some education behind them, but I kind of figured that there was, you know, some older people out there. And for instance, my dad is would be a great example. you know, he goes to the website every day and he hits that, but he also has other websites, and he just, what he'll do is he'll go from one website to the other. Sometimes they're updated, sometimes they're not. Sometimes, you know, there's a story that he wants to read, and maybe there's not or whatever. So, I kind of imagined a bunch of people just jumping around from place to place to place, not really using readers or not having all this great content in one place. So I just kind of thought it'd be great. It would be great to have, you know, the best articles that I find up on one place, and, you know, it would be easy for me to find. And then if I was talking with someone or sharing something with my dad, I could say, hey, go to the website and I've got a couple of, you know, neat articles up there. And, it just kind of developed from there.
Yeah, I know the first time I saw a prepper website, I thought, wow, it's Drudge Report for preppers. And I hope you take that as a compliment, because I'm a big Drudge Report fan as well as a prepper website fan. But, it's great, and it does, and it's kind of like the doorway to the rabbit hole there.
Yeah. No, I'm a big fan of Drudge too. And so I hit actually, you know, on my computer at work, it kind of stays open. It doesn't, you know, Drudge Report tends to refresh, on its own. So every once in a while, if I'm there, whatever, I kind of see it, or kind of visit it a couple of times a day. But yeah, I mean, I think a lot of people are very familiar with Drudge. It's a very popular site. And I think they're used to it. And especially people that are going to be, you know, in the preparedness community, I think they're hitting Drudge as well. So it's something that they're very familiar with. And not only that, you get to put a lot of content on one page. I mean, that's one of the things I struggled with. I know some people have responded, you know, it's an ugly theme. You know, and I'm okay with that. I haven't been able to find anything that's similar where I can put a lot of content on one page that it doesn't eventually fall off. And so that's kind of why I sought that Drudge Report theme out and have used it.
That's very cool. And your latest creation is preppersmallbiz.com. Can you tell us a little about that site and how we can get involved in it?
Sure. One of the things that I've, in dealing with businesses and advertisers and sponsors, and then all the reading that I'm doing with people, or all the articles and stuff like that, I know that people are out there. There's definitely the finances are hurting. One thing that I felt that I could do was provide a place where preppers could support other preppers. So, you can get on Twitter and you can search and you can do all those kinds of things, and you can find various sites that are promoting, you know, a certain person or a certain business. But I thought it would be a good thing to have a bunch of prepper businesses all in one place. And so really, Prepper Small Biz serves as a business directory. It just launched a couple of weeks ago. It serves as a directory for people to find small businesses, maybe that are owned by preppers, that they can get behind and they can support. So I have that focus. I also have the focus of I'd like to be able to have a place where there's a lot of reviews. So if you're looking for a product, that there's a review up, and you can go there and you can get, you know, somebody in the preparedness community has done a review on, you know, whatever, a certain flashlight or whatever it might be, a piece of gear, and you're able to see that, you know, on Prepper Small Biz. One of the things, and it didn't initially start out like this, but I had some people, you know, write to me and say, hey, it'd be a good idea if you did this. We also started the book of the month. So, you know, somebody that writes a book is a prepper, and, you know, basically they're doing a small business there. And so every month, and we have August through December already filled up, there is a featured author and a book to go along with it. And the authors who you know agree to come on agree to you know go to their page, go to that post of their book and you know read the comments and interact with their fans and with the readers. So for instance, the first one that we have kicking it off is Michael Bunker, and he's written Wick. And he's also now, I mean, it was a four-parter. Now he's come out with the omnibus edition, so it's all four parts all in one. But he is we are featuring Wick 1, which is a free download, and it's been downloaded a lot. I mean, that was I thought it was a great book. And so if you've read the book, or you can go download it and read it, and you can come back and you can leave Michael Bunker a comment. And he'll come back and he can respond to it. People can start talking about it. I think, you know, that's a great point. I mean, you read a book and your mind starts going like, whoa, I wonder what, you know, why the authors decided to do this or why, you know, why that. And you can come and you can you know, correspond with the author there. And chances are a lot of other people have that same thought as well. And then also just kind of bouncing off of that, because in the preparedness community, you're going to have preparedness, you know, novels, books, stories that you know talk about a certain aspect of preparedness, and I can just kind of picture people just kind of running with that and talking about that and really making it you know real for you know for their lives. So we have that. I guess the whole other reason why I've kind of started is I want to encourage other preppers to have multiple streams of income, because I do believe that, you know, there is going to be an economic crunch. You know, the sad thing is down here in Texas, and you know, going back to my journey, the 2008 recession and the economic downturn, we knew what was going on. We knew, you know, the banks that were failing. We knew that this was happening and that was happening. The Dow, the stock market, we knew that, you know, gas was going up. But our lives weren't affected too badly. I mean, we had to pay a little bit more at the pump. You know, there was, you know, talk, you know, we had things to talk about, you know, in regards to the news, and I can't believe so-and-so's doing this or whatever, or why is the government doing this? But it just didn't affect us like it affected a lot of other people around the country. And still, even today, I live in Texas. We're still, our economy is really, really good. You know, I had a meeting at school with a couple who they lived in California, and they loved it and they wished they were back there, but they had to move because of economic. You know, their finances and stuff and finding jobs and all that kind of stuff. And they're not the only one. I've had to deal with a lot of people from California moving to Texas. And so, I understand that, you know, our economy is a little bit better down here. I'm not as affected as other parts of the country. But I do understand that when there is an economic crunch, or, you know, if something was to happen, I want to have multiple streams of income that I can draw from, so that my main job is not my only source of income. So I guess Prepper Small Business is also a push to encourage other people to think about what they can do as far as, you know, bringing in a little bit of income. And so maybe starting a micro business or a small business that can, you know, that can help their family and help their finances and help them. Now, if the economy turns down for them.
Sure, it's sort of income diversification, just like you would have diversification in your stock portfolio or anything else. It's if one thing takes a hit, then you still got the other things going.
Exactly.
Can you give us a quick synopsis of your book, Education After the Collapse?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the Education After the Collapse kind of marries my job as an administrator, as an educator, and what I've learned in the time that I've spent in preparedness. One of the first articles that I ever wrote, and I sent it, Modern Survival, and you can get it, you can click to it on Prepper website. You can go to the About on the top right hand corner. The little drop-down menu, you can go to the About Mission, click there, and then I have some of my first articles written there, or at least you can link to it there. And I wrote To Modern Survival Online, and it was a prepper's nightmare. And my nightmare is always, you know, when you're first in get into preparedness, you get into the whole fear thing. And, you know, for me, reading books like Lights Out and One Second After, being an educator, I guess, you know, being an educator and thinking what would happen if something like that happened during the day when I was an administrator. And so I have a whole school full of kids, and in where I'm at, my elementary school is, you know, I have 1,000 students. So I have 1,000 students. There's an EMP that is one of the, you know, there's people who think that EMP, there's all different kind of ranges. I mean, some people believe that it'll knock out, you know, your phones. Other people believe, you know, it'll go the gamut and knock out every electronic device, no matter what, you know, and send us back to the, you know, to the complete dark ages. And so my thought was always, what would happen if I was, you know, if I was at work, if I was at school, and this kind of happened? Well, you know, that's something that nobody ever plans for. That's something that no district ever really contemplates. So I guess, you know, within the preparedness and thinking about preparedness and working with all that, I tend to bring in the education part a lot of the times. And, you know, one of the things was, if there is a Mad Max scenario, and again, there's all different types of people, you know, run the gamut, and I'm not saying that there is going to be a Mad Max scenario. I'm just saying, if there was, you know, what would education look like, you know, during that time? And so when I wrote Education After the Collapse, I have like a chapter, a fictional chapter that takes you through, you know, a little story, just a one chapter type thing. I have a chapter on learning styles, a chapter on, just kind of the education where we've kind of been, where we're, you know, the way the education system is kind of set up now. I have a chapter on reading, how to teach reading, a primer on how to teach reading. How to teach math, a little chapter on science. Then I have some flashcards, the alphabet flashcards, and I have science measurement benchmark flashcards, all in that ebook, that free ebook. And so my main purpose for writing, I guess I have three main, the intention of it was, the first thing was, to provide some kind of guide for people, if there really was a collapse, you know, what would they do? How would they go about doing it? At least to get them to start thinking. You know, there's people who homeschool right now that for them, it's just going to kind of be business as usual, right? There's going to be a lot of people who have no idea what to do. And for instance, my primer on reading, and we all read, we all learned how to read, but it happened in stages that we just don't remember anymore. So teaching somebody how to read, you know, we're going to open up a book and say, okay, here you go, start reading. You know, really, where do you start from there? So have that one aspect, that one purpose. You know, what would education after a collapse look like? And then the second reason, purpose is, I want parents who pick it up, or if they pick it up, that they have some real strategies that they can use. So the reading strategies, if you have a kindergartner who is reading or is learning to read, you can read that primer and you get a good idea of what you need to do to help them, to read, to be successful in reading. If a parent who has kids who are learning math, using manipulatives, teaching them how to teach math, going from a concrete aspect to a pictorial to an abstract way of doing it. And then I do also have learning styles in there. So there's modalities of learning, and people learn we can all learn in various different ways, but some people tend to gravitate to one modality over the other. So you have like the visual learners, you have an auditory learner who listens and learns better that way, and then you have kinesthetic learners who have to, you know, touch it, feel it, hands-on kind of learners. So, I mean, that's a pretty good synopsis of the book, you know, taking care of all those things. And I guess the third purpose is that if somebody picks it up because it's a free education book and they're not into preparedness, I would hope that it would get them to start thinking about preparedness, or even thinking, you know what, this might not be too far-fetched of an idea. You know, I do talk a little bit about economics and stuff in there, about the reason for the book. So hopefully that would kind of turn some people on to preparedness, you know, in a roundabout way.
Very cool. Do you think the collapse is preventable, or do you think we've already crossed the Rubicon?
I mean, I guess it's, you're really thinking about what that collapse is going to look like. I mean, from all the reading that I do, and at the beginning, it was just the people on the fringe, the alternative media. Now you have people, you know, real economists saying, hey, there's something here. Even the guys on the talk radio here in Houston, I've kind of, you know, even yesterday, I was listening to them it was a financial show, and they were talking about, you know, when things turn down really bad. So they're expecting it. So I think more and more people are starting to realize and kind of expect it, that it is, that there is going to be something that happens. I just don't know what that's going to look like. So if it is a, you know, Mad Max scenario, Patriots, you know, James Wesley Rawls, you know, Patriots type collapse, if it's going to be a slow spiral down, something like, you know, that's happened in Argentina, or, you know, in Russia when they kind of collapsed, and then eventually, or Zimbabwe, you know, eventually, you know, getting a little bit better or whatever. I really don't know. I think that everyone knows that our system is done for, as far as there's no way that we can ever fix it monetarily. So if we stop today, stop spending all, you know, stop spending everything and then just trying to start paying off the debt, I mean, there would just be no way. And especially if the interest, you know, starts to go up on us. So I think it's a mathematical certainty that it's going to collapse. The question is, you know, what's it going to look like, you know, on, you know, the day after the collapse? Is it going to be a hiccup? Is it going to be, you know, there's going to be some panic? Are there going to be some spots where it's worse in the country than others? Or is it going to be a complete meltdown? And I think that's, you know, that's the question that everybody has in wanting to know. You know, we can look at Argentina, we can look at Zimbabwe, we can look at other places, you know, that have had some struggles. But I think, you know, America is always, you know, there's going to be spots that are, you know, different than others. And so I think that's going to be the key. You know, what's it going to look like the day after the collapse?
Yeah, and I guess if you're prepared for the Patriots Mad Max scenario, you're prepared for any lesser evil as well.
Yeah, no, I do agree with that. I mean, if you prepare for that, yeah, you're going to be better prepared if there's just a little hiccup. You know, one of the things, you know, I was talking with a friend the other day, and he talked about we need to move away from emergency preparedness to just a preparedness lifestyle. And I think that's, you know, I think initially when people get into preparedness, they start, it's from the emergency preparedness point of view, you know. Something can happen, you know, I'm preparing, you know, a hurricane can happen, you know, tornadoes can happen, you know, a winter storm, all the way to, you have people, you know, EMP, nuclear war, whatever. But I hopefully we would move, we would get to that point where it's like, okay, you know, the EMP has not hit yet. You know, I've got to go on with my life. I'd rather live a life of preparedness than a life of emergency preparedness, always waiting for the, you know, the balloon to go up. So I think that's an important key. And I think that comes with, a little bit of maturity in preparedness, a little bit of spending that time in there, that happens. But yeah, I do agree with you. If you're prepared for the big hammer to fall, you know, you'll be able to weather all these other things.
And public education is delivering different results in different geographical areas. For instance, DC is among the nation's lowest with a 59% graduation rate. Two states with the highest graduation rates are Tennessee and Texas with an 89% graduation rate. What are Texas and Tennessee doing right, and what is DC doing wrong?
You know, we don't usually get data on other states per se. We really don't get data on even our state, other schools in the state. Sometimes we get data looking at other schools within our district. But what I would say is, looking at DC, I think there's a whole culture of corruption over there. I think that you can do that. I mean, just recently, I'm not a big fan of Walmart, but, you know, Walmart was trying to find inroads over there. And I think, from what I understand from the news stories that I heard, on the radio, is that eventually they just pulled out because it seemed like they were just targeting Walmart. And so DC lost out on jobs, on, you know, getting people employed and stuff like that, because they were trying to pass laws that were just focused on Walmart. So you have that. Now, when we talk about Texas and Tennessee, I think one of the problems, it kind of irks me when I listen to people talk about public education. They tend to say, you know, hey, they're making this amount of money and they're doing this. Why are they complaining? You know, why are they protesting? You know, but don't they know that the economy is rough and tough and everybody, you know, needs to do their part? Or you look at the teacher unions in Wisconsin, and when they went to the Capitol building there, and there were I was almost ashamed as an educator, because you had a lot of educators there who looked silly, who looked really stupid, chanting and doing stupid stuff, and it was just kind of you almost felt, you know, embarrassed as an educator. So the thing that I would want people to understand is that there's pockets, even within Texas, that has better graduation rates than, say, DC, like you were talking about. You're going to find districts in Texas that have a worse passing rate or graduation rate than DC. You know, it's an average, but you're going to have pockets. And so when people talk about education and they talk about, you know, these people, you know, they're just into it for the money or you know, they just want job security, they don't care about really working, I would say don't generalize, put us all in one basket, because it's very different. You know, even here in Houston, you know, the main Houston ISD is you're going to have more liberal people, but I've worked for a district out, you know, in the suburbs, and we're more conservative. Of course, you're going to have very few people that are liberal and stuff like that, but you're not seeing a lot of Obama stickers, you know, in the parking lot. And so, I mean, that's one thing to kind of remember. And I'm not familiar with DC and with their state requirements. I know that here in Texas, we have requirements that students have to pass certain tests before they're allowed to graduate. And so there's a lot of emphasis put on the academics, for students to pass, you know, to hit those standards into the course, tests that they need to take. Right now our state mandated test is the STAR test. And so there's a lot of there's a lot of emphasis there. One thing that I know that our district is focusing on, in the past we were always a district that focused on going to college, and everything was college readiness and getting kids ready for college and taking four maths and four sciences, because that gave you a better chance of getting into a better college and gave, you know, gave you better results and stuff like that. What they're realizing up top is that not everybody's cut out to go to college. So we're finding out that the push now is college and career readiness. So getting those students past high school, and then what, you know, trying to give them a focus. So there is a route. If you're going to college, there is a graduation route that you need to take. There's courses that you should take that a college would want you to have. But if you are not college material, you don't want to go to college, you're not going to college, you know what you want to do, and you want to do something else, then there's a route for that as well. And so I think that helps in boosting up those graduation rates, because we do have that focus on realizing that not everybody is going to go to college.
And for the 41% of the kids in D.C. and other cities similar to that, like you were talking about, there's pockets all over America that have really low graduation rates. How are those kids going to compete in an increasingly tight job market?
One of the things to consider is graduating from high school going to – does that automatically mean that you're going to be able to compete in the tight job market? How much does personality, how much does your ability to work hard plug into it? Because, for instance, as an educator, I've had students in my classrooms before who were very, very smart, who knew that they were smart, who didn't have to do a lick of work, who could get the test and ace it. And then I had students who struggled, and maybe they were a C student and they were struggling. They struggled in the classroom. They went to extra tutoring. They, you know, worked hard at home with their parents. Maybe parents set them up for tutoring. They just really busted it to get that C. Now, which one would you rather have if you were an employer? Would you want someone who just kind of skirts by and, you know, is able to do it when they want to, or someone who's going to really work hard at it? So, you know, students have to have those basic skills. But when you talk about the job market, you know, I guess you got to kind of look at that. I mean, there's a guy who goes to my church who has, he's had entry-level positions at his job. And what he's done is he's given students like the basic GED test. And so he's not looking at high school. He's not looking at even, you know, do you have any college credit? You know, can you do the GED? Can you get the GED done? And then let's look at some of your work habits. Let's look at, you know, do you have a passion? Do you have a desire to work? So I think that's important. Besides that, I think that the students or the kids that are graduating, at that 41% who are not graduating from DC schools, I'd like to look at what DC has in place for them, what the school district has in place. You know, are they focusing on college and career readiness, or are they just college readiness? Why are they not graduating? What's going on there? Is it the teacher unions? Or do the teachers make school, you know, so boring that students don't want to learn? I mean, there's a lot to consider there.
In the early 60s, the Supreme Court ruled against prayer and the Bible in public schools. Are we better off or worse off now? And how do you think those rulings have affected public schools?
All right. Well, I'm probably going to say something that would be contrary to what you think I would say. Yes, I don't like the fact that we don't have prayer in school and all that kind of stuff. Has it affected Has it affected us as a society? Probably. Now, I believe it's more the result of people. People not standing up. Christians not saying something. So when they started to pass those laws, you know, why didn't the Christians stand up and say, whoa, wait a minute, you know? We feel that we need to, you know, have this, and let's have this dialogue, and let's do something about it. I believe that, you know, if you're coming from a spiritual perspective, I think it's, you know, the churches and Christians are just, you know, when it comes to spirituality and their faith, are just weak nowadays. So, I don't think as far as when you talk about, you know, taking the Bible out, because if you look at the Bible as an academic book, if you're just reading it academically, it's not going to be powerful. It's just a book, you know, just a history book. You have to have the spirit behind it, the faith behind it. And so I think more, it's not necessarily we took God out of public schools and then society went down. I think society took God out of their lives and society went down in general. And so you can look at just the way things have deteriorated. And I don't know how old you are or how old the demographics of who listen to the podcast are, but you know, it's been steadily going down. I mean, I can remember when you turned on the TV, you heard a curse word, or you saw something inappropriate. It was because you had cable and you had one of the premium channels on cable. You know, nowadays it's on prime time, you know, and even at that, it went, you know, started growing, you know, slowly and slowly and slowly, and they kept pushing more and more and more. No one ever said anything. No one ever fought against it. People just accepted it. You know, and I think that's been a big issue. I think, we are worse off, as a nation, as a society, as people of faith, but not because we took it out of the public schools, more because we just became lackadaisical things had just become easy, and we haven't had to really kind of fight for our faith, if that makes sense.
Sure, but you would certainly agree that creationism was replaced with the myth of evolution. And I think that probably gives kids this idea that rather than being divinely created, that they sort of just happen and they don't really have any purpose and they're an animal, and so we maybe shouldn't be so surprised when they act like animals if that's what they're taught in the schools. But I agree with what you're saying. It's not necessarily causal. It's all just part of this big slippery slope that our society got on, and it's all just kind of interrelated and sort of a big negative feedback loop.
Yeah.
So what do you think about Dr. Ron Paul's homeschool curriculum? Have you had a chance to look at that at all? You
know, I have not had a chance to look at it at all. I've seen it a couple of times displayed. I listened to Lou Rockwell's podcast, and I know that he's mentioned it in passing, but never really, you know, went into it. So I really can't speak on that very well. I mean, I know that Ron Paul is probably, if he's going to put his name on it, you know, it's going to be liberty-minded more than likely. So, but I can't really speak to it because I haven't looked at it at all.
Yeah, I haven't either, but I bet it has a big emphasis on financial literacy and probably a lot of American history in there too.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's something that I'd like to look at. I do think that if you are homeschooling, having a curriculum is important. I've dealt with, you know, and I'm not against homeschooling, not at all. I'm totally for it. Even, you know, especially if you're doing it for, you know, religious reasons and stuff like that. I always, before I got into education, and that's a whole nother conversation, I always, you know, thought about maybe homeschooling my own kids. But I've had some experiences with kids who've said that they were homeschooled. But what their homeschool consisted of was sitting on the computer for 2 hours a day, doing a, you know, some software program, and that was it. And then for whatever reason, the parents send them back to public school, and then they're not prepared. So you know, if you have people that are homeschooling or you're considering homeschooling, do the research. I mean, I think it is. I have known a couple of homeschool. I mean, we even had one teacher at my school who was homeschooled up until she went to college, and you know, very smart, very intelligent. So I think it's very, very viable. But if you're doing it, do the research, make sure you're going to be consistent, and you know, make sure that you're doing it again for the right reasons. I had a parent whose son was always getting in trouble, and she's like, I'm just going to homeschool him. And, you know, she had no idea what homeschool means. She doesn't know. You know, I'm thinking, you know, it's like she's probably going to go get, you know, like a little workbook and that's it, you know. So I believe that, you know, there needs to be a curriculum, and, you know, there needs to be some consistency, and there needs to be, you know, a pattern, a schedule that you kind of follow.
Yeah, people need to find out what they're getting into before they commit to that. And I guess everybody can't do it. I guess there's a lot of single parents out there as well that it's just not physically possible for them. For single parents, is it harder for kids with only one parent to do well in school?
You know, I really can't say yes or no. I mean, I know what statistics would say. I know what people would eventually, you know, bring out and say, you know, one household parent can't do everything that a two household parent could do. But I have known some single parent households where the kids were awesome, you know, that they were great kids, that they worked hard, that they were, you know, they tried really hard and not necessarily that they were A students, but, you know, they knew that when they were at school, they needed to put forth effort. So, you know, it all boils down to the parent. It boils down to how they're raising that child and their expectations. You know, I've had other single parents who are raising, you know, a kid, and they're working, they're having to work two jobs to kind of make ends meet, and the child comes home from school and makes a dinner on their own and watches TV and plays video games, and or goes outside and then kind of get in trouble because there's nobody there to kind of help. But again, I think that every situation is different. To be able to say, you know, yes, every student who's a single parent has a single parent is going to have issues or not going to do well, I don't think that's fair to say, because I've seen the opposite of that. I've seen where kids have been very successful and have done really, really well with just one parent.
So it's just a case by case thing. And I guess transversely, you could say that there's probably a lot of kids with both parents that neither parent's involved at all, and maybe they don't do well.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And I see a lot of that. I see a lot of two parent income, keeping up with the Joneses. And the kids, you know, they have everything they possibly could want, you know, an iPad, the latest Xbox, you know, whatever the latest phone. But, you know, what they really need is a parent to be there for them.
And for that single mom that's doing the two jobs just to make ends meet, and the kid probably has to just come home and let himself in and make himself dinner and things like that, can mentoring programs like Big Brothers, Big Sisters, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, would that help those kids, and would it help them do better academically?
I think so. I mean, thinking back on some experience, there was a student who had he was a single parent, and he was involved in football, and elementary students are not, you know, they don't have football like you would have in middle school or high school. You know, it's a it's a sports association that parents sign their kids up, whatever, whatever. But that coach was very influential in that kid's life. So I know that there was times where the kid wasn't doing what he needed to be doing, and the mom, you know, I'd call the mom, and the mom said, you know, tell him that you were going to call coach, you know. And I would say, hey, your mom thinks that, you know, I need to get your coach involved. And you go, oh, no, you know, I'll do what I need to do. You know, so you have that positive influence there. Parents, you know, kids that are being raised by a single mom, I think, you know, sometimes in Boy Scouts and big brothers, big sister, those kinds of things, you know, they can have that male role model that'll be there. And I know another guy that goes to my church is very active in Cub Scouts because his nephew was at one point, but then his nephew kind of pulled out. He kind of stayed in there. And he mentors a lot of those kids that are, I think now they've moved from Cub Scouts to Boy Scouts, but he mentors a lot of those kids, you know, and he's the type of a person that'll sit down with you and help you figure it out and won't give you the answers, but will help you figure it out and let you know that he's going to be there for you and, you know, be there as a support. And so I think that's a great, example of, a role model being there for somebody. And so I do think that those kind of programs are important. The thing that I see, though, are when the kids don't have access to get to those, you know, those programs. That's the hard thing. You know, they're going home. They live in an apartment complex, and they don't have someone to come pick them up to take them to Boy Scouts, or they don't have someone to take them to Big Brothers or Big Sisters or something like that, to involve them. You know, mom or dad is working all day long. They get home, they're exhausted, and, you know, jumping into the car and going, you know, somewhere else for another hour, 2 hours is kind of rough. So I kind of understand that as well. So, you know, you got that catch-22 thing going on.
Yeah. I guess churches are a really good access point for those types of programs, though. My church is huge, and they have Boy Scouts and Big Brothers and Big Sisters, as well as other just a mentoring program that's just through the church.
I think that neighborhood churches have a great opportunity to reach people like that when you do that, you know, when kids can get there on their bike or kids can get there by walking, or even if they have a bus. Years ago, we ran a church for young people, and we didn't call it a youth group. We called it a youth church, and it got so big. Here we had kids, they would not leave. So I remember the first couple of services that we had, they would not leave. So it was like 10:30, 11 o'clock, and I'm like, hey, guys, don't y'all need to get home? Aren't your parents worried about you? And they're like, no, and we're good. And so, you know, it got to the point like, well, here, let me take you home. It got to the point where we had to buy a van. We bought this old van from someone that someone knew, and we had a paint job donated, and we had some cool stickers put on the side of it, and kind of fixed it up a little bit and put some new bench seats in there. And we would wind up taking kids home, because there were so many that would come. There was many times where I would have to make two trips. So I would load up a 15-passenger van, go drop them off, circle back around, pick up the next 15, and then go drop them off. So I think churches, neighborhood churches, are really set up to do that. And I would hope that they would open up their churches to that. So I'm glad that your church is doing that.
Sure. And how important is improving Americans' education to being able to prevent the collapse or rebuild after the collapse?
I think everybody, especially even educators, will tell you that education needs to be revamped. That, you know, I know that in my district, and we talk about it all the time, kids learn differently nowadays. Basically, the system of education that we have is based on the Industrial Revolution model of the factory, where kids were in the factory. You went in at a certain time, you punched in, you did your job, You ate your, you know, you ate your lunch, you did your job, you punched out. And the same thing is true for education today. You punch in at a certain time, you do your thing, you sit down in rows, nice, neat rows, you do your work, you go to lunch, you go do your work some more, and you punch out. And it's basically it's the same thing. The Industrial Revolution needed people that could follow those types of rules, and so that's why education was like that. You know, education and churches are the two organizations that, you know, that don't want to change, that don't like to change. You know, we had a superintendent in my school district a couple of years back who wanted to approve online learning. For instance, we know that students that are in high school, teenage students, we know that their biological clock really does not start kicking off till 10 o'clock. But we have things called like, I think they've stopped it now, but we used to have something called zero hour for students who were in sports. So if school started at 7:30, zero hour was 6:30, so that the student could come get all their classes in and still do the sports that they wanted to do. But we know that that's not effective. I mean, it would have been, it's more effective for a high school student, and anybody who's listening who has a high school student knows that they, you know, they stay up late and they want to sleep late. And that's just their body. It's not because they get into a routine. I mean, there is a little bit of that, but research shows that their biological clock really starts kicking off around 10:30. They start really learning at that time. So, you know, if schools really wanted to innovate, they should, high schools shouldn't have their first bell until 9:45, 10 o'clock.
And, wow.
You know, that screws everything up when you think about education, everything that you've ever known about education, but that's the way it should be if we were doing what was best for kids.
Yeah.
The other side of that is I'm kind of torn both ways, okay? So I've got this, the preparedness, the self-reliance, the self-sufficiency side in me. I also have the education side of me that is the higher level learning, the technology-based, kids need to be able to function in a world filled with technology and whatever that means. But I also think, so I think there needs to be a merging of both of those types of things, where we teach kids real skills. For instance, in my elementary school, we have a gardening program for third grade, and even this year, we're going to start to incorporate some of the other grades to come out as well. So a third grade classroom during their science time, once a week, they go out to the garden. There's someone who is teaching them about gardens, and we have like milkweed, so the butterflies will come, and they can track butterflies, and they have that. We have a thing that helps to attract bees, and they grow all different kinds of vegetables and fruit. And then they also eat it. So they'll weed the garden. They'll plant the seed. They'll water. You know, they'll see it being watered. They always don't, you know, they don't water it themselves, but they see it being watered throughout the day. And then they pick the fruit themselves. So they realize that, you know, fruit and vegetables aren't coming from, you know, the grocery store. This is really coming from the ground. And I think that's very valuable. So being able to merge somehow those two types of things together and giving kids real skill. You know, there's some things that we don't need to, I at least don't believe, you know, unless you're going a certain, and that's the other thing. I think it would be a good idea to be able to set certain treks. So if you have a kid who is good at math, who's probably going to be an engineer, kind of set them, you know, on that path. That's one difference that where we're different here in America. We have a law called FAPE, and it's a free and appropriate public education. And that means that every student who is of the legal age to go to school can go to school or should go to school. And that covers everybody from a student who is cognitively disabled to where, let's just say, they're in a wheelchair and they can't even move. All they can move is their eyes. There are classrooms, there are life skills classrooms where those students would go into, and they would develop a curriculum to kind of help this student. That student would answer by moving their eyes. So you have that all the way from regular education all the way to the student who is a juvenile. So here in America, if you are a youth, if you're school aged and you commit a crime and you're in the juvenile system, then you get an education that's free and appropriate to where your placement is. And so we have kids in the juvenile justice system that are locked up, but then at some point during the day, they go to school. And that's not the way it is in other parts of the country. When they start comparing us with other countries in the world, when they start comparing us with them, it's not really fair, because there's a lot of students in other parts of the world, and they start acting up, they're kicked out of school. You know, or they might not have it together in math, so they put them on a trek that's, you know, hey, you're going to be a janitor, or you're going into the army, or you're doing this because you're not able to do this. That's not the way that we operate here. I had some friends. I had a teacher friend who had some missionary friends who went to Holland, and their kids were very meek and very, very quiet. And just, good kids. And they thrived over there in Holland. But in Holland, if a kid was being a bully or if a kid was acting up, they just expelled them. I mean, they didn't play games. So if you're done. Here, that's not the case. In order to get suspended and expelled, I mean, you're having to do some repetitive things. And even at that, expulsion, in our public school system, we deal with discipline on our campus. Eventually, if it continues and it's worse enough, I can't even talk now. If it's bad enough, they'll go, discipline will be handled on a campus, on a district level. And then if it continues from there, maybe they enter the juvenile justice system. And that can be a long, long trek. But that's not the way it always is in other countries in the world. They just, they might look at a student and say, hey, we don't think that you're going to be capable of becoming a doctor. We don't think you're going to be able to be an engineer or, whatever. You need to go this way. And they make that decision for you. So I think that there's you got to kind of keep all those things in perspective. I do wish that we taught kids more real life skills, in school, to get them to be a little bit more self-sufficient and self-reliant. But that's why we prepare, and that's why we try to teach our kids skills and stuff so that they do have those things if they're needed.
Well, you've given us a lot to think about, and we'll have links in today's show notes to PrepperSmallBiz.com as well as Prepper website. Can you tell the folks where else they can find you?
Prepper website, Prepper Small Biz. I do two issues every year of something called the Preparedness Review, and that comes out, like I said, twice a year. It comes out in November and in May. This last May, we released our second edition, and since May till today, it's been downloaded over 28,000 times. And so basically, the Preparedness Review, it's a PDF made up of articles from all over the preparedness community. Some are older articles that authors have contributed. Others are written specifically for the Preparedness Review, but it's just, a lot of good information. I think this second edition was over 70 pages of stuff. So, really good stuff there. So I would, if there's people out there who haven't heard of the Preparedness Review, you can link to it on prepperwebsite.com, and you can get over there and you can download a free copy of both editions. And then, I guess kind of, I have another site where I kind of rant. I kind of do guest posts. When someone, I get a lot of people who email me about wanting to do a guest post on Prepper website. And because of the theme, after a little while, I realized it's not a good theme to post regular blog posts. So I use Ed That Matters, E-D, you know, Ed like education, thatmatters.com. And that's where I kind of, it's kind of a catch-all. I might rant one day. I might put up a post, that I've had in my head. Guest posts are up there. I might link to something funny there. And so I have that Ed That Matters. And then that's where also you can get the free ebook Education After the Class at edthatmatters.com.
Very cool. Todd, thanks so much for taking time to come on today's show.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for listening to another edition of the Prepper Recon Podcast. If you're new to prepping and you want to learn more, you can check out our 7-step survival plan. It's under the category section on the left-hand side of the page. Until next time, happy prepping.